Have been having trouble tonight?
Oh, yeah.
All righty. Welcome to hour four. Commander McLean from Naval Junior ROTC coming up to Prescott, Arizona from Moon Valley. This hour he's going to be talking about the flying portion of the Navy and question and answers from the vast audience. All right, Commander McLean, you have it.
Thank you. Good morning. Yeah, I'm Commander McLean, and real briefly, I did serve in the submarine service, and then I also served in the surface fleet for 13 years, including two tours on aircraft carriers. So I am familiar with some of these aircraft. They're rather interesting. Okay.
Can we get content? Content. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm working on that right now.
So the background of naval aviation, it started with this guy named Eugene Ely. 1910, he was the first pilot to complete a takeoff from a ship. And then in 1911 was the first one to actually land. Now you think about that, the Wright brothers just shortly before that actually invented the airplane, and then just a few years later they're already flying them off of ships. So it was pretty quick. Now the Navy tried four distinct ways in which they could use aviation with the fleet. They did aircraft carriers, they did flying boats, they did these things called lighter than aircraft, dirigibles, blimps, and then they did these pontoon things where it was an aircraft with pontoons on the bottom. There we go. Yes?
What's a pontoon?
A pontoon? This thing that let me see if I can find one here. See it right here?
Yeah.
It's a device that floats on water. And so by putting it underneath the airplane like this, it can land on the water and it'll float.
Okay, I see.
Okay?
Thank you.
So they tried all four of these things.
Oh.
What a good question, right? Floating structures, such as a float on a seaplane. Man of war is a general term for an armed naval vessel. So they tried to put these things on men of war. Okay? The second era of naval aviation involved jet aircraft, giant carriers, helicopters, and long-range patrol planes. So let's talk about some of those. Okay. First, the USS Langley. That's a strange-looking ship, isn't it? It really is. That's because it was designed first as a coal carrier. And so none of this was on it. It was used to carry coal. And then the Navy got this idea and said, hey, wait a minute, why don't we put a flight deck on top of it and we can land and take off planes? So that's what they did. They just put a flight deck on top of a regular ship that wasn't designed to be an aircraft carrier, and the Langley was the first one. We're going to go back. I want to see if I can get that for you.
The scaled-down American Navy began experimenting with a radical new idea, the aircraft carrier. An old coal ship, the Langley, was fitted out with a flat deck, and daring aviators risked their necks taking off and landing on it.
Now, when they say they're daring aviators, today's supercarriers, they have these things called catapults that hook up to the plane or the jet and speed it up to where it can actually get enough speed to where it can actually take off and fly. It has enough wind under its wings to fly. These guys were taken off without a catapult. If they didn't have enough speed before they got to the end of the ship, splash. Yeah.
Okay, so on the boat, the top part where they're flying off, what's the length of that, like, to where they can actually take off?
I'll answer that in just a few slides.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
It's longer than a football lineman cares to run. Who was the first pilot to complete a takeoff from a ship?
See?
You're right.
Sorry.
All right. Okay, during World War II is when air power came into its own. December 7th, 1941, and then the big battle of aircraft at Coral Sea. That's when all of that really came into play. So here's a carrier that's damaged. These are all sailors. Looks like they're abandoning ship. Three important improvements in carrier aviation after the war. The angled flight deck came around in 1952. What that allowed us to do is allowed us to take planes off and land them at the same time. Steam catapult in 1954, that allowed us to get those heavier planes to be able to get enough speed to take off. In the carrier world, they call that making, when we speed up the ship. So let's say, for example, you need a ship needs a certain amount of wind to lift up the plane. Well, one way you can do that is you can just make the ship go really fast, and it's called making your own wind. So you turn into the wind, that gets you the wind from nature, and then you speed the ship up, and now you've got more wind, so you're making your own wind so you have enough lift to take the plane off. Sometimes that's not enough, so they have a catapult. That catapult hooks up underneath the plane, and it changes the speed of the plane from zero to 150 miles an hour in 2 seconds. And in nuclear power, came about 1961. That made a big difference for the carriers. So the angled flight deck allowed us to launch and recover airplanes. So we could launch and recover at the same time. That would allow you to keep more planes engaged at the same time. They could come in, they could rearm, and they could take off, and you could do a lot of sorties at the same time. Okay? The steam catapult is shown here, and you can see that in this particular case, we're taking planes off from either from all four catapults, because there's two more catapults over here on this angled deck, or it could be that this guy missed the wire. As you come in, you hook the wire, and then you go down. As soon as you land, you touch down, you go to full power and try to take off again. Because if you miss the wire, you got to have enough speed without a catapult to get airborne before the end of the ship. So the first thing they do is they hook the wire, and as they're going along, there's a guy, his job is actually to run out there and wave his arms and let them know that they caught the wire. So I don't know if he's taking off or if he missed the wire. The catapult is right here. This is called a jet blast deflector. There's a bunch of seawater flowing through these things because when they're taking off, they're going the full throttle. So they're full throttle, and that jet blast is going right here. It'll knock a guy off the ship if they don't put that deflector there, so it deflects it up into the air. Okay. When nuclear power came along, it accommodated more planes and larger crews. Because now the power of the ship can be generated by the reactor plant. Your electrical power can be, your electrical demand on the ship can be more. Your range on the ship is completely different. You can go for 25 years without having to pull into a gas station. That's a long time to be able to go do that. Okay. You can remain at sea for a lot longer. In fact, you can remain at sea for 25 years if you didn't have to do maintenance. And then you can go a lot faster. So what was the battle in 1942 that between aircraft launched from carriers?
Yeah. B?
You are correct. All right, aircraft. Lighter than air aircraft were used for scouting missions. So here you can see we've got a blimp. Today we use helicopters for scouting and rescue missions. Okay, let's talk about two different types of modern aircraft. Fixed wing and rotary wing. Fixed wing. They're used to strike against the enemy. They protect the fleet from enemy aircraft. So they're going to go up. There's going to be some people flying around up there above the battle group to make sure that the enemy doesn't get too close. It's not that you want the plane too close. It's the weapons on the plane can't get close enough that they can travel and hit the battle group. So you're extended out quite a ways to make sure it doesn't happen. You perform undersea warfare, photography, and escort. And they perform reconnaissance and early warning. The rotary wing, amphibious operations, the one that comes to mind is obviously Korea, but also most of the time when people think about rotary, they're thinking about the Vietnam War with all the helicopters and everything else that went on there. Search and rescue missions. Anytime an aircraft carrier, for example, is having flight ops, there are two helos off to the port side of the ship, about 3 miles, and they're just flying out there in case anything happens to go get the pilot if somebody has to eject. Okay, aircraft model designations. Okay, they're all the same for all the services. The letter specifies the basic mission. So, for example, An F is a fighter. Has anybody ever heard of an FA-18? So fighter attack, and an 18 we'll get to in a minute. So you can see this whole list of different things that these things would do. So for example, I think you mentioned somebody was P-3 pilot?
Yeah, P-3.
Okay. Mm-hmm. P-3 is patrol. Okay. They're out there looking for submarines. Okay. So that's the letter. The number indicates the design number of that aircraft. So for example, it's the 14th fighter design, F-14. So what would F-18 be? It'd be the 18th fighter design, F-18. And I think there's now a, there's more on the drawing board, so eventually that's going to go away. I think there's a 22, mm-hmm. Okay, F-22. Okay, in a particular design, if it's modified, then at the other end, they put A, B, C, D. That's the revision number. It's the same thing as saying, like, for example, in a book, if you look in the front cover of a book, it's the first version, the second version, the third. Okay, so this would be the second version of the Viking. So it's an S-3B, meaning it's a second version of this third design. So a modification is an alteration or adjustment as an aircraft or other vehicle. The difference between the design and the modification is the basic thing is still there. If you take your car in and you put spinning hubcaps on it, that's a modification to the original design of the car, but the original car is still there. That's the difference. Now you can change the basic mission symbol by adding another letter. And I think they give you an example here. A drone is an unmanned aircraft or ship. You could put it in the front. So here's an A6, and then we talked earlier about an A6B. Well, now this one has got an electronics package added to it. So it stuck it in the front and said, okay, but this one's been modified. It's got this special other equipment. It would be like going and getting a F-150 or an F-150 Lariat or an F-150 Harley-Davidson version. They stick that in the front. So this is just an electronics version of this same plane. Skip that. Okay, besides being used during the Korean War in amphibious operations in support of the Marines, what also delivered supplies, equipment, and personnel to ships at sea?
Helicopters.
You think helicopters? Let's see. You're all right. In the aircraft designation S-3B, what does the letter B indicate? I saw you mouth the answer, A. You just didn't say it. All right. So Navy aircraft of the same type are organized into squadrons. And that's so that the same type of pilot, the same type of plane can train and they can gain experience and knowledge working with each other. They have all these nice patches that they have. And then on the side of the aircraft, they'll actually paint these logos on there. You'll have the Black Knights, all kinds of different logos. They're divided into aircraft of various squadrons combine to make an air group. An air group is onto a carrier. So here's the George Washington. And if you look carefully at the picture, you can see up here, we've got a reconnaissance plane here. If you look right, here's another one. Here's another one. You have obviously the F-18s. And then I thought I saw a Gila one here too. Might be folded up right over here. Okay, and then they've also got what they call a Greyhound, which is a COD, carries in the equipment. So a VFA is a fighter attack squadron. So those would be like F-18s. VS is sea control. VAQ, electronic warfare. That's that one that we talked about earlier, where it had version B and it had the electronics package to it. Okay. Fighter attack aircraft. The single-seat F-18 Hornet is the nation's primary carrier-launched strike fighter. It can drop bombs, but is also designated as a fighter plane. During the initial phases of the war, When these guys took off from the carrier that I was on, you would sometimes see them disappear below the front of the flight deck. They would just dip down. They didn't quite have enough speed to really be in total control when they first took off because of the amount of bombs they were carrying. Yeah.
Is there two planes right there? Because that looks like extremely crowded. I don't
know. No, that's one plane.
Oh, my goodness.
Two tails.
Okay.
These pilots are really good. Really, really good.
Not as good as F-15 pilots, so.
Okay, so the F-18 replaced the F-14. Okay. F-18, that's flown by the Blue Angels, and that's what they use now. Remember I mentioned the logo? So this is on the side of each plane, and then also on the side of each plane is the name of the pilot and his backseater. So they'll both be painted on here, and that's their plane. Okay. So it can do air superiority, reconnaissance, air defense, suppression, precision strikes, close air support, and fighter escort. When they talk about precision strikes, I can share one story with you. During the initial phases of the war, there was a critical bridge that we needed to maintain for supplies for future use by us. On the far side of the bridge were a bunch of enemy combatants. They could not uproot the combatants. So they called in a guy from a carrier, and he skipped. He came in, he feathered, or I don't know how the pilots do it, but he basically threw the bomb under the bridge to where it skipped up into where they were. And they had it on video. It was a pretty neat shot. So, very sturdy plane. Okay, it can take a lot of hits, and it can keep on going. It can come back, and it can fly another day. When it comes back to the carrier, there's all kinds of shops on the carrier, and they'll do all the repairs in the hangar bay. And it's kind of weird because you go up there at night and they do the repairs in the dark. But they have light that doesn't affect their vision, so they can see really well, even though to me, when I would walk up there, I wouldn't be able to see it. But they'll work on them all night, and the next morning, 4 a.m., they're taking them off again. And so here's a modification where you can either have one seat or two seat. It can go up to 50,000 feet and fly over 1,300 miles. That's a pretty good plane. Okay, electronic surveillance jamming will replace the EA-6B Prowler by 2010. So that's coming out now, the F-18 Growler, and it's replacing it to where you can go in. They'll go in ahead of the other planes and jam all the electronics so the people, the enemy can't track you. They can't see you. Okay, Navy groups of aircraft of the same type are grouped into what?
C.
Squadrons? And as it happens, that's the same as submarines. Submarines are squadrons as well. True or false? The new Super Hornet has a longer range than the earlier models and is even tougher than the Tomcat, but it costs 40% more to operate than the F-14. True or false?
False.
EA-6B Prowler is a twin-engine mid-wing aircraft designed for carrier and advanced base operations. Provides an umbrella of protection for strike aircraft by jamming enemy radar, electronic data links, and communications. So they go in ahead, jam all that stuff so nobody can see you. What's this thing here for?
Is that for the speed? So
no.
So that it can register the speed?
That's so it can get a drink of fuel while it's flying. So they'll have other tankers that'll take off from the carrier, they'll fly a little boom down, and they'll refuel them mid-flight. So that's how they get their gas when they're flying. So they don't have to land. Okay? Goes fast. It's got a ceiling of 37,000 feet and a range of just a little bit shorter than the F-18. Okay? It's got four seats in there. So it's got three electronic warfare officers in there doing all the jamming. The E-2C Hawkeye is an all-weather carry-based tactical wing warning and control system. We saw a couple of those. I think there were three in the picture that we saw when we looked at the aircraft carrier. So this is part of their electronic package. It's strange to see one of these take off of an aircraft carrier. You've got this big, giant plane with this big disc on it. You just think there's no way that thing's going to be going fast enough. But it doesn't. Okay? It's surveillance coordination, strike and interceptor control, search and rescue, and it relays communications. And then again, just like Navy ships, these planes all have a specific purpose kind of in mind. So this guy's going to go out in front of the battle group. It's kind of like some of the ships that will go out in front of the carrier. They're there for a specific reason. The ones on the side of the carrier, they're there for a specific reason. That is, they will speed up or slow down to take the missile hit so the carrier doesn't get hit. They're shielding the carrier. See, so the E-2C Hawkeye carries a crew of five. Again, three people in there as mission system operators. It's got a little bit longer range. This is an interesting one because it serves as a communication relay for the fleet ballistic missile submarines and can launch land-based ICBMs, intercontinental ballistic missiles. So this one's kind of a very interesting and important one. Feet, 7,500 miles, and has top speed of 600 miles per hour. What four-seat aircraft protects strike aircraft by jamming enemy radar and communications in a combat zone?
B.
B? What all-weather tactical warning control system aircraft flies in front of the battle group and provides early warning and command and control?
B.
You are correct. Undersea warfare, the P-3C Orion. It's the Navy's only land-based anti-submarine aircraft. So this guy goes out and tries to find the submarines. So then the surface vessels that are designed to go kill the submarines can go get them. And they have a variety of things on there that help them find the submarines. Yeah?
Might have missed this, but if the plane is in the air and submarines are underwater, how the heck does that even work?
They have a bunch of different sensors and types of equipment on the plane that they could use to locate and find the submarine. Some of them are things that they'll drop into the water. They can check the water, they can listen to the water and transmit back up to the plane and say, yeah, I found something. Sometimes it's they can see it. The water, you know, the submarines can go deep, but submarines are pretty big, so they can cause a pretty good shadow at night, depending on where the submarine is. They might be able to see a trail. There's a lot of different sensors on them that are used and designed to do that. So we're going to get rid of the Orions, and we're going to replace them with the P-8 multi-mission.
Commander, is that a civilian aircraft that's been converted, or is it specifically built for that? Do you know?
I think it's specifically built for that.
It's unusual looking.
It just looks different here.
Mm-hmm.
And the front up here is different. It's sharper.
From that picture, it kind of looks like it's a computer animated from that picture.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it does. Okay. So the S-3B Viking, carrier-based twin-engine jet, it's detect and destroy submarines. Drops mines, surveillance, and refueling. Okay. So if he detects a submarine, he'll go out in front of the submarine, he'll drop a bunch of mines, and then the submarine will run into him. Mile range is a pretty good range. Okay. True or false, despite the P-3C Orion's numerous changes and upgrades since it was first delivered, the Navy plans to increase the numbers after major airframe refurbishing. You don't believe that? You're right. Logistics aircraft, okay. The C-2A Greyhound. It's a twin-engine cargo passport plane. I flew in on and off aircraft carriers on this one. It'll carry about 15 people plus some supplies. And the most important thing of all, they call it Pony. On an aircraft carrier, as soon as this guy lands, they'll say, Greyhound 25 on deck with 450 pounds of pony for Carl Vinson. Pony is Pony Express, which is mail. So as soon as he lands, they report how much mail they have, and then they announce it over the ship's loudspeaker so everybody knows mail arrived. So the pony is the thing you want. Okay. Logistics, the aspect of military and naval operations that deals with the procurement, distribution, maintenance, and replacement of material and personnel. If you think about it, a ship's out at sea. Where do they get everything? You got an aircraft carrier out there with 6,000 people on board. That's a lot of food per day. If you're feeding everybody three meals a day, that's 18,000 meals a day. It's a lot of food, a lot of soda, a lot of milk, a lot of eggs. So it's got to be delivered, and a lot of parts. Depending on the part, the critical parts will be flown out. Up to 10,000 pounds of cargo. So the really important stuff that we don't have on board, it's going to be flown out on the COD. And it'll be flown out real quick. The other thing the Navy uses these CODs for is they fly people out to the ship that are transferring or leaving the ship. SkyTrain DC-9 is used primarily for fleet logistics support. I guess you can say this is like the UPS plane or the FedEx plane. Okay, and then there's a smaller plane that's used to go between naval air stations. Interesting that it's a United States Air Force picture. I just caught that.
I know.
United States Air Force. To the rescue again. All right, and then the Hercules, a four-engine turboprop aircraft capable of takeoffs and landings from short runways, very short runways. And they carry a lot of cargo or a lot of people. So which cargo aircraft has undergone the most design modifications? You remember we talked about how to determine that? A, B, C, D, E, F. Modifications are out of the alphabet. So it'd be the Huron. And then the Navy's got trainers. I think all of the services have basically the same trainer, the T-34C, and then there's another trainer. Okay, and this is to train the pilots. First, initially, they learn just the trainer to learn how to fly. And then once they learn how to fly, there's another plane that teaches them how to land on an aircraft carrier. There's actually an aircraft carrier flight deck on land that they practice on land with a stationary flight deck. And then they go out at sea and they practice landing on the carrier. And even when they're qualified as a pilot, they then periodically have to do so many day traps, which is a trap is when you catch the hook, and night traps within a certain time frame to be able to continue to fly. And we're transitioning over to this T-6. Now we have unarmed aerial vehicles, yeah.
On the other plane that you're just showing, the red one, there was something on the side that looked like a hole, like what?
Let's take a look. You mean this?
The other plane.
Oh, a little bit further back?
Yeah.
Okay, let's take a look.
There's that.
That's the intake for the engine.
Okay.
Okay, so we have drones. And they're initially a land-based system. The Navy now uses it at sea as well. They're actually testing a plane that is pilotless. And they're actually getting ready to start landing it on the aircraft carriers. So it's bigger than a drone. It's an actual plane. They think the biggest problem with it's going to be convincing the guys standing on the flight deck that it's safe. That psychologically it's going to be hard for them to understand that a computer is going to be landing that thing on the flight deck.
So it says right now they're being used at sea, but they're not being landed on any aircraft. Or
the drones can.
The drones are small.
They're small.
That they
yeah.
They're that, about to land on that flight deck.
They catch them with a hook.
And they have a
they can catch them. They can take them off. But they're looking at using them on aircraft carriers much larger.
Right.
For example, on an aircraft carrier, the parking of the planes and how they maneuver and manipulate them, they have not been able to figure out a computer program that will allow them to do that. It's not done by computer. It's done by people, and it's called the Ouija board. Mm-hmm. And they actually have models of all the planes, and they have to figure out how to move them around because you've got to look at the list of the ship, when are they going to be needed, which one needs repair, which one needs fueling. Mm-hmm. It's a dance.
Sure.
And the choreography is hard to do. What two-seat aircraft provides primary flight training for Navy and Marine Corps student pilots?
B.
B? Do you agree?
C.
All right. Rotary ring aircraft. Okay. Helicopters become an important part of the naval operations. Okay. They can do a lot of different things. This is a helo delivering supplies. During UNREP, which is when we're bringing supplies onto ships at sea, because you don't go to port to get your stuff, you got to stay out at sea. They'll bring a couple of pallets, and there'll be two helos going on between the two ships, and they will do a dance where every 60 seconds, one of them is dropping pallets on the ship. By dropping, I mean landing and then disconnecting the cables, and then he's going to go to the other ship, and they're going to go back and forth. So every 2 minutes, that helo's dropping pallets of food on the ship. So the Seahawk is a twin-engine helicopter. Its primary mission is to detect and destroy enemy submarines. It's got dipping sonar. It can fly out. Hey, I think I see a submarine. They'll fly out there. If they'll dip the sonar down the water, and they'll listen. They'll see if it's a submarine. So they're designed to do anti-submarine warfare. And it's on cruisers, destroyers, and frigates and carriers. So on all of those ships, there's a small control tower, if you will. Now, on an aircraft carrier, it's obviously air traffic control is a big part of the aircraft carrier design. But on the smaller ships at the aft end of the ship, there's a small little booth. And when the helo lands, the rotors are about 5 feet in front of the person who's controlling the helo as it lands, that's talking from the ship to the helo. They match speed of the ship, and they come in, and they just come in. And it's neat when you see those rotors spinning right there. Okay. Mine warfare operates from carriers and other warships. Its primary mission is airborne mine countermeasures, seeking out and destroying enemy minefields. That's the MH-53E. The M, of course, telling you it's mine. H, helicopter. Okay. And then we have training as well. I don't know this for sure, but it appears as though orange is the training color. Okay, what twin-engine helicopter is used to detect and destroy enemy submarines?
A.
You think A? I think you're right. Okay. And then the V-22 Osprey is a helicopter that becomes a propeller aircraft. So it takes off and lands like a helicopter, and then once it's up, the nacelle, that thing out here on the end of each wing, rotates, and it flies like a regular plane. So a tilt rotor is an aircraft that has its rotors at the end of each wing, which can be operated vertically or vertical takeoffs. Okay. Moving over there. Okay. So they rotate 90 degrees. The ceiling is 25,000 feet and can go in excess of 270 knots. Look at the size of the propellers, though.
They're huge.
And I also, because of that size, they have to land vertically. They can't come in and land like a normal plane.
So if it's broken and they can't rotate, then you're kind of just
land.
Screwed. You have to bail.
That's what it looks like. They did, when it first came out, have some problems with the control of it. It wasn't as popular. It didn't take off in popularity with people. But I believe the Marine Corps is sticking with it. Okay. Limits of the VITOL causing some question at its safety record. However, the Marine Corps is sticking with it. They like it. Yeah.
Is there a possible way, like, to eject out of one of these?
Most aircraft have a way of getting out of them.
Okay. So a lot of aircraft.
This plane, a propeller plane, generally doesn't eject.
Right. Because if you eject out of here,
slowly. Yeah, I know. I was going to say you're going to die.
You're like the cucumber on the relish dish.
That's when you open the door and just jump.
Okay. What word does the letter V stand for in VTOL?
Vertical.
Good job.
So you think C?
Yeah.
Let's see. You are correct. Okay. Conclusion. Naval aviation began its first years of flight. First carriers in the 1920s. Actually, remember 1910, 1911 was the first takeoff and landing. Okay. But it wasn't really until World War II that it really took off. And then after that, the nuclear Navy took off from there. So a nuclear carrier can operate for 25 years without having to refuel.
Can you go back though one more?
Sure.
Just go back. Okay, looking at that, and so explain exactly how the planes can take off and land at the same time.
Well, they're okay. The planes that are currently located here would not be there.
Yeah, and you take off.
Here's a jet blast deflector, and here's a jet blast deflector. So here's the catapult right here. So that pulls up here, and it can get launched off the straight part
of
the deck.
Not at the same time, but soon after each other.
Almost simultaneously.
Huh.
Then here's another jet blast deflector, and you can take off two more jets from here. And the other JBD is, it's hard to see, but there's a JBD up here. These jets would not be here. Probably right here, these seven would not be parked here. And then they could come in and land right here. That's as long great. As they're not taking off.
Sure.
So they land on the angle deck, and then if they miss the cable, they just take off this way and it won't affect this operation.
That's
at
good.
The back here, there's four cables stretched across. And they're about that far off the deck. The cable's about 2 inches in diameter. When they come in, they're supposed to catch the third wire. And every pilot is graded on which wire they catch. If they see a trend towards them catching the second wire or the first wire, they'll be called aside and they'll get some more training. The further back you go towards the back of the ship, the more dangerous you're landing. And it's a chance that you're going to hit the back end of the ship, because remember, the ship is moving like this through the water. So if you're going to come in a little light, it's going to cause you to get closer to the deck and you're going to have a hard landing. You're going to end up damaging your aircraft.
The third wire is the last one?
It's the second to last.
Second to last. So
there's
four
wires.
They missed that one, they've got one more.
They got one more to go.
Right.
Second to last wire from the end?
So one, two, three.
Gotcha.
Is where you want to catch, and then there's a fourth wire.
Okay.
Any other questions on the carrier? There are elevators. There's an elevator right here. There's two planes parked on this elevator. There's two planes parked on this elevator. There's an elevator over here. That's the third one, and there's a fourth one up here. Four elevators. They can take all these aircraft and put them down in the hangar bay to where the top of the ship will be completely empty. We went through a hurricane, and we had to have all the aircraft down in the hangar bay all honkered down and chained down because of the weather. The rain would go in one side of the hangar bay, and it blew out the other side without hitting the deck.
When they do refueling and bomb loading and all that, is that done on the flight deck or down below, and then they bring them up?
In the mess decks, there are elevators for the bombs. They come up to the mess decks where people are eating, and they finish assembly of the bombs on the mess decks. So you could be eating your turkey dinner here, and there's a bomb sitting next to you getting put together. And then it goes up to the plane, it gets put on the plane on the flight deck.
On the flight deck itself?
On the flight deck.
And they refuel on the flight deck too?
On the flight deck.
Right.
This here is Tilly. This thing is always manned. And if there's a problem with a plane on the flight deck and they got to get rid of it, Tilly pulls over and throws it over the side. Whoa. Just get rid of it. There's too much up here to risk all of this for one plane. There's firefighters constantly on the flight deck. There's a whole fire department that just does nothing but fight the fires on the flight deck.
Like that one right there.
Were you ever on stationary aircraft carrier?
Twice. I did two tours.
And how long was the tour? Or how long were you at sea?
9 months. At one time, and typically 6 months when we would deploy. A deployment normally happens every 18 months. And then about the first 4 months before you deploy, you're gone about 3 months of that. Because you go out and you're doing carrier ops, you're getting qualified, you're getting all your squadrons, all have to qualify on this ship before they can deploy.
When you're gone for 9 months, do you have any idea how many planes have problems or pushed over the side or anything, an average?
I never saw one go over the side.
It's rare.
It's rare. Well, forestall fire, they call it the forest fire, the forestall fire. That was actually John McCain's plane. That what happened is his plane caught on fire, and once it caught on fire, the ordnance on it started firing off, and it started firing into other planes. And then the other ordnance started going off, and so they ended up with, they lost 175 people.
That's a bad day.
Because they just couldn't get the fire out because there was so much on the flight deck going on because it was actually during a war that they just couldn't get the stuff off the ship. They just started pushing it off. So, it's neat to watch these guys on the carriers do their landings. As engineering officer to watch, I would sit in central control. I control the reactor plants, but my other responsibility was to watch the takeoffs and landings on a camera. They call it the Platt camera. So I'd watch the takeoffs and landings, and I would adjust the ship's speed based on what the air boss wanted, and then the speed, the steam to the catapult. But when I would watch the video, if you took that video of a takeoff and you superimposed it over the video of another takeoff, the movements of the people on the flight deck, the actual movements of the guy telling him to speed up his engine, holding up the sign saying this is what your weight is, the guy that's telling you to bring in the catapult and hook it to the plane, the guy that says go, if you superimpose it on the video, it would look like one video. It is that precise and that exacting of emotion when they're up there. It's just like a ballet. It truly is. It's just amazing what they do. Sure. They start flying at 4 in the morning. We usually finish up about 2 in the morning between parking all the planes, moving everything around and all that. It only takes one F-18 before we have to start adjusting the list on the ship.
Say that last part again.
It takes parking of one F-18. Mm-hmm. When you park that F-18, I have to adjust the water on the ship to get it balanced again.
Oh, okay.
To get it to an even keel. Because you don't want it over too far, because if it's heeled over, it's going to affect the takeoffs and the landings. Mm-hmm. So you're constantly, there's a ballast control system that pumps water port to starboard to adjust. Very sophisticated.
We have about 6 minutes.
Okay. Any questions?
I've got one quick one. I know it's a big ship and it's not like bouncing around the waves, but how much is the deck actually moving during flight ops? Up and down?
If you're on a really nice day, it's really a nice seas and it's real, you know, maybe 6 feet, 8 feet, mm-hmm. but it can go 20, 30 feet.
Wow.
Yeah, it can get pretty hairy. When we had that real bad weather, as a matter of fact, the air boss actually grounded all of his pilots. Once they landed, they couldn't take off again. Mm-hmm. The problem they were having, though, was the weather was so bad, some of the pilots, they just literally couldn't get down and land. It was too rough. So all they were doing was taking off the tankers. They would take off the tankers would go up and they'd refuel them. And then the tankers would have to come back down and try to land. And they would just continually just risk the tankers because the other guys, they couldn't afford to risk having them try to land. And it got so bad, he actually went down and he said, okay, that's it, everybody's grounded. I'm flying the last one. And he just continuously flew until the weather got enough to where we could get him down.
This is like a hurricane or what?
Yeah, it was really bad. Really bad weather. Right. Yeah, I only saw that once. There's 3 wardrooms on the aircraft carrier. Wardroom 1 and 2 are for the pilots. It's not just for the pilots, but typically they eat there. And that's where they all are up there talking about their flights, and they're in their flight suits. And that's where all of the good cereal goes. You get the individual cereals, all of the Captain Crunch, the Fruit Loops, all of those cereals go up to Wardroom 1 and 2, and the Wheaties and Cheerios are down in Wardroom 3 for the rest of the crew. There's a couple reasons for that. Those pilots are out there on the tip of the spear. They're really out there under a lot of stress. So if I can get them a box of cereal that's going to make them feel a little better when they get back, that's great. 2, they got to eat quick. They got to get in, they got to debrief, they got to eat, they got to go to sleep, then they got to get right back up again and start flying again. So their wardroom is a much more relaxed, much more open wardroom where they can get in there. They don't have to worry about what they're wearing. It's a less formal wardroom. So that's neat about an aircraft carrier is the wardroom. That's 17 stories. I know because I used to have to do it twice a day. I'd have to start out where I worked and go up, talk to the captain, go back down again.
But how many planes are parked
How about embarked or on a carrier on a deployment? It's 85 to 90.
Wow. Yeah.
85 to 90 on a typical deployment.
Okay.
Other questions? Nope.
6,000 guys on board.
6,000 men and women.
Wow.
When the Air Wing's on there, it's just over 6,000. When they're not there, it's 4,500.
Must seem deserted.
Yeah, it really is. It's amazing what that 1,500 difference makes.
Right.
Yeah.
And how often would you be at sea without the Air Wing?
The only time the air wing is on board the ship is during a deployment.
Okay.
So other than that, they're not on it.
For testing and not.
Well, when they're doing their qualification, their carrier calls, it'll initially start out to where their carrier calls, they're going to come in from a land base because they want them to have a what they call a bingo field. So if a pilot's having trouble on their carrier calls, they don't want to force him to have to land on a carrier. They can get ashore and they can land on a shore base. So it gives them that opportunity. And then once you go into blue water, then they have to all be qualified before they're on the ship.
Right.
The helos typically will be flying right out here, about 3 miles out from the ship during flight operations, so that if anything goes wrong, they can go retrieve the pilot.
Now, you mentioned earlier there was two out there flying. Why two?
I think they just go out there for, you know, I'm really not sure why, but I know there are two that typically take off and they're out there.
Okay.
It may be just something as simple as
one gets busy.
One's a backup,
yeah.
You know, for the other guy, and it would take so long to get it up there, and getting the rotors up here, it really takes out the flight deck. So it's possible that it's just a standby.
Sure. Makes sense. How many years were you in the Navy, Commander?
25.
And how much of that time were you out at sea?
Probably, literally away from home, probably close to 17 years. 16, 17 years.
All righty. We have about 1 minute.
Yep.
Why don't you please turn it off?
Thanks, guys.
And I want to thank you very much. Give him a round of applause.